Hello, and welcome to Ask Authors Anything, the YA middle grade Q&A series devoted to famous writers, favorite books, and fangirling. I'm Megan McCafferty, and I am back as host after taking a turn as a guest on my last episode to celebrate the publication of my 10th book. I have to do that. Okay. All right. So, but it's not about me today. I wanted to do something different with this episode. My previous guests that I've had on the show, Sarah Dessen, Lori Hall Sanderson, Rita Williams Garcia, Gail Foreman, Rebecca Stead, all of those whose episodes can be seen on YouTube or on the Ask Authors Anything Tumblr or on Amy Poehler's Smart Girls at the Party. So, you know, check those out. All of those authors were veteran authors in the business. And so I thought it would be interesting to do something different this time by interviewing a newcomer to the world of young adult books. And when I read my guest's book, Say What You Will, I knew that it had to be her. This book is fearless and funny in the most just refreshing way. There were so many times that I said to myself, wow, that was bold. That took some guts to write what I just read. I am far from my alone from my admiration for this book. It got starred reviews from Booklist and Publishers Weekly, was a top summer reading pick by People and Entertainment Weekly, and just the other day it was put on the long list for the American Library Association's Best Book for Young Adults. And if it isn't put on the short list, I just might have to stage a protest. she is the author of 3 novels for adults and also a co-founder of Whole Children, a resource center for children with special needs. She's about to embark on a book tour, so I'm very lucky to have her here today. Please welcome Cammie McGovern. From Central Regional High School, my alma mater, in Bayville, New Jersey. So, welcome to the show. Thank you for coming, everybody. I appreciate you all doing extra reading this early in the school year. So, thank you all for coming and being here and preparing such awesome questions. So, Cammie, Say What You Will receive the kind of reviews that a writer can spend an entire career waiting to get. So how does it feel to be compared to the likes of Rainbow Rowell or John Green?
Oh, I wish that, I feel like the publishers compare that to,
it's not just the publishers. I read plenty of reviews that said the same thing.
Those two are so exceptionally good at what they are doing that they are in a league of their own, and one doesn't want to try to live up to those comparisons too early on. I actually really do believe that. They especially just hit the mark. I mean, the two biggest books, but both of them have, they're so consistent with all their books that are such a pleasure to read. I hope that I've been writing for a while, so I don't feel like such a beginner, but I am new to this, and I know I can, one doesn't want to have your best book be your first, does one?
Right.
Best YA, and so I'm hoping I'm only getting better from here.
Well, I imagine something like that is a mixed blessing because it while incredibly flattering, it also it might make you put a certain amount of pressure on you. But also, I think as writers, we want to be known for being you don't always want to be the next so and so. You want to be the new me, or you want to be Cammie McGovern, just like I want to be known as Megan McCafferty, right? So I always find those, I mean, like I was described as Judy Blume meets Dorothy Parker, and it's kind of like, part of me was like, I want to have that tattooed across my chest for everybody to see. But at the other point, I'm like, that might just be the best review I will ever get in my entire life.
Yeah, so I hope I'm only growing from here and getting better. I I actually do feel like I'm incredibly proud of this book, but even I can see there are certain things where, and it's interesting how one does read Goodreads reviews, doesn't one? And I've started reading the lower stars. In the beginning, you're only reading the people who are...
Why do we do that?
And then you go lower, and I actually think some people have made some good points, and I feel like, oh, I'm going to learn from this, because mostly it has gotten good reviews, but I know how I can go better, and it's about trusting that one doesn't have to go overboard on story, that one can trust readers and character and that kind of thing. I think people raised some good points that were subtle and really smart and intelligent. So I feel like hopefully I can only get better from here.
I do the same thing. I read Goodreads reviews. I tend to read the negative ones, and I read it for the same reason that you do, because I'm like, what if they're right? I think that sometimes the more there's like the ones where just like, it sucks. All right, okay, fine. but the negative reviews that actually raise valid points, those are the ones that are scarier, because they kind of, it's closer to the truth, maybe.
Yeah.
Right?
What a good point, yes. So, it's hard to read those in the beginning when the book first comes out, because you just feel so vulnerable, and so as if you're powerless to do anything. And then it's actually a nice feeling, you get a little bit further from the book coming out, and you feel like, oh, it's on its own now, it has set sail, and I can now handle it if some people have a few good points to make.
I have a feeling we could talk about this a lot longer, but I'm going to move on, because we have so many fantastic questions from my co-hosts from Central. So let's get right to it with a question from Amanda.
Hi. I was wondering, when did you decide that you wanted to become an author?
Oh, I was... that's a great... Great first question. I was a teenager who loved writing all the time and kept a diary, but actually not until I stopped by the time I got to high school, because work gets too hard. So I did it all through middle school and elementary school. And it never occurred to me that you could actually be a writer and make a living at it until after I graduated from college. So that should be very encouraging to anyone who's already knows and has the confidence to say, this is what I want to do and this is what I want to be. You're already way ahead of me. But by the time I graduated from college, that very first year, I was secretly writing all the time, even though I was doing other jobs and living in New York City. So I knew somewhere in me, it was just hard to say it out loud. And then I was starting with screenplays and plays because I was living in New York and working in theaters. So it took me a long time to even come to fiction and realize that. So it was a long and circuitous journey.
Aspiring writers are often told, write what you know. So Cassidy has a question that ties directly in with this idea.
Oh, good.
I was wondering if you know anyone with OCD or cerebral palsy, and if they inspired your characters in any way.
Well, I missed the tail end of that question. If I know anybody who has cerebral palsy, and what was the last part?
If they inspired your characters in any way.
Yes, as a matter of fact. So my oldest son, who it's horribly possible he'll walk in the middle of this because he's coming home from school any minute and I forgot to tell him.
So is my son. So
my oldest son is 18 years old and he's got autism. And so that was, Megan mentioned the center Whole Children that I started when he, 10 years ago, we're celebrating our 10-year anniversary, which was an after-school center for kids with special needs to do after-school classes, socializing, movement-based, music, theater, arts, all those kinds of things. And there was a little girl who was part, her mom was part of the founding group of that, and she has cerebral palsy. And so I thought of the idea for the story when she was just a little baby, so a long, long time ago. And now she has grown up, and she is 17. She's a year younger than my son, but they've gone all through school together, and now she is his girlfriend. friend, and I'm putting the quotes before he gets here because he wouldn't like quotes around it, but they're a very sweet friends, basically. But they did go to prom together, and she is not really the character of Amy because she doesn't use a talking board, and she's just very different, but she's where I originally got the idea.
Wow, and so this story has been brewing for 17 years.
For 10 years. I originally wrote a draft, so while I was writing adult novels, I wrote an adult novel that had this character that uses a talking board, and it never worked, but there was this little part that was set in high school that I liked, and so I just pulled that out with this, she makes a friend called Matthew, and I was very frustrated because I was writing adult books that weren't working, and I thought, I'm going to take this little part, I am going to write a book that works if it kills me, and I took this little this high school part, and I wrote it really quickly because I was so mad at myself. I don't know if, Megan, you've ever had that where you've written some things that don't work, and you're mad at yourself,
oh, yeah.
And you've got to get that works.
But I think what you just said about, you know, you wrote this whole big thing and then you this just small piece of it,
yes,
turning into say what you want is a really important point in that why, you know, you have to get through a lot of bad stuff before you can find the good stuff.
Yeah,
which is the importance of why if you're interested in writing, you should just write and write and write and write, and it might be that the only thing, like, for example, I mean, Sloppy First, the title came from a completely different short story that I wrote when I was in college. Like, you never know what gem can come out of a bunch of garbage. Not to imply
garbage.
That your book, you were writing. I can say in my case it was garbage.
No, I can say the same.
All the writing is worthwhile, even when it's pretty bad. And because I think a lot of people get the impression that things come out fully formed, like that, you know.
Well, I think that's the big thing. That's what separates beginners from the people who've been at it for a while. Just know you're not. It's really about rewriting, and it's about knowing when that you throw a whole lot of stuff away. And it's funny, Sarah Dessen had this great set of tweets about all of her ideas that she had thrown away, and she just, like, went into it. I don't know if you saw
that. I did.
And then she said at the very end, all of these felt like good ideas at the time. And when she's tweeting about them, it's not necessarily, it doesn't seem like it, but it's true. You really can't tell what you're writing that's good. And what feels good is often not what comes out at the end, because I didn't think the high school stuff was charming, and you set it aside for a year and you come back, and this Amy and Matthew stuff, it was clear that was the only part that was you can bear to read almost.
You know, while reading the book, I couldn't help but wonder, because it was about teenagers, whether you encountered any resistance from anyone on the path to publication, and Emmy has a question about that.
Okay.
Was it riskier for you to write about teens with disabilities over your average teenager?
Was it easier? Was that the question?
No, riskier.
Oh, riskier. Oh, because I don't have a disability myself, and I don't, so I've got my son, and I know him very well. I think my motivation there is that I feel like we need more of these stories told, and so I gave myself permission to also just say that these experiences are wide and varied, even with autism, which we're seeing more books and stories and movies and TV that have characters with autism or somewhere on the autistic spectrum. And what you quickly learn and figure out, and the whole world is figuring out, is that there's a wide range in that experience, and there's a wide range of possibility, what they're good at, what they're not good at. And so as long as you stay specific to a particular person, what I thought was risky and what I was nervous about was actually her talking board and getting that correct. Mm-hmm. And I'm surprised because I had to take a few liberties with that because the actual reality about those talking boards is that the language that comes out would be a little bit not quite as easy as Amy's dialogue is in the book. It would be a little bit more stilted and a little slower than I had to write, but nobody has written me and told me that, which I'm surprised, because I would think there's a whole world of people that are highly intelligent using talking boards, and I would have thought I'd heard more from them saying this isn't exactly accurate to our experience. But I think it's because the spirit comes out, and that's what I wanted. I needed her. That was one concern early on, was that she's a little too articulate considering she's nonverbal. And so I pared it back a little bit, but not a ton.
Right. I think her character transcends the truth. You know what I mean? And by taking liberties, it becomes its own truth. I mean, that's the beauty of writing.
That's what I'm hoping.
And it is fiction. And so I think that if people weren't rooting for the character or didn't believe the character, then everything would fall apart. Like, they could pick apart it all. But because she's such a vivid person, and I also, very few people know the facts, too. That's the thing. I mean, so you want to please everybody, though, right? So even though it's a very small percentage of people who would know the reality of these boards, I know from my own experience, it's like you don't want to make them mad. You want to be able to get it right. But sometimes getting it factually right is a detriment to the story, and you went with what was there of the story, and I think that's obviously and was the best way to go, and many, many readers agree, so.
That's exactly right. I wanted the spirit. What I can say from knowing a whole lot of kids and teens with disabilities, is that their spirit is so large. That's what I think I wanted to get, and oftentimes one of the big surprises is how joyful and they are about life, that what looks to many of us from the outside like it might be a sad or hard life is almost 80% of the time not true, that they've long ago adjusted to whatever their disabilities are and whatever their limitations are, and they're very passionate, loving, joyful, and you don't want to make stereotypes about disabled teens, but that's the pleasure of hanging out with a lot of them, is that they love whatever they love, and they embrace life. They're very happy to be here, and they're very happy for whatever relationships they can have and friendships that they... So I think that's what I wanted to capture, is that it's not a sad life for most of these kids.
You just mentioned, things that surprised you as like what you've learned about people with disabilities, and the novel caught me by surprise many times, and so that kind of segues into a question from Katie.
When you started writing, did you know everything that would happen to Amy and Matthew?
Oh no, I'm not one. Did I plot out the whole book beforehand? Is that the question? No, I didn't. And so I knew that I wanted it to get darker and larger, meaning that, so everybody's read the end and we won't have spoilers, but that they have to come up against a real test of both their friendship. So I knew I didn't want it to end with either going to prom or having it be too simple in that way. And that's why I sort of kept going into the darker place. And that could have been partly because she had had this adult book idea where something sort of similar happened. And but I do not write from an outline ahead of time. If that's a question that you're asking lots of the writers who are coming on, I write a whole collection of scenes, and the scenes that come out the best.
Yeah.
And seem the most alive and the funniest. Often the funniest is because that's what I'm going for, as you are too, Megan.
Yeah.
Or the richest somehow. And often I'm writing scenes that I think are going to be the direction it goes, and it's not the direction, and I can cut it early on because I'm not. It also makes you write a lot more and throw away a lot more by not writing from an outline. But I never have, really.
I'm similar in that way. So I mean, a lot of times when I start a book, it's not the start. Very rarely is it the start. It's the scene that speaks to me the loudest, and so usually it's somewhere in the middle. And then I have to figure out, well, what happened to get to that point? And it makes, for me, it makes it more fun too, because like sometimes I used to agonize over starts, and then I remembered, like, I can fix that later. Like, I can work on the start later. That's what the revision and rewriting process is all about. But I think it's important to get those scenes that are most alive to you down, because that keeps that energy going to actually then put it together into a story that hopefully will make sense when you're done.
Yeah. And do you have where you end up starting a little bit further into this story that you get things going instead of throat clearing, as we used to say, for a long time, spending a long time? Yeah.
So we have a lot of questions about characters, and I'm not surprised by that, just because the characters, Amy and Matthew's characters, but all the supporting characters are so vividly drawn. Let's start with a question from Erin about your characters.
Did you put any of yourself into Matthew or Amy?
Oh, that's a good question. I would say I actually related much more to Matthew than to Amy for myself as a teenager. I was much shyer than I am now, and full of, I don't think I had OCD at any time, but I think, and I've learned this more as I hear from readers, that everybody understands that kind of thinking, that we all at different times when we have felt powerless have made deals in our brains with how we can control something that will happen. If we do XXX, then this will work out, then I will get invited to the party, then something good will happen, or I will prevent something bad from happening. And I remember that very well. And I remember being afraid and thinking I was being watched all the time and that somebody was out there and going to punish me or something like that. I just remember all of that kind of thinking, and then I started reading more about kids with OCD and started learning all these surprising things, which is that it is much, much more common than you think it is. That if anybody has a touch of OCD, you have lots and lots of company. It's the mental illness that afflicts the sanest people in the world. And I felt like, oh, that is so interesting, all of those things. And I read a few memoirs of people, and I thought, oh, I just understand this disorder completely. And so that I connected to more myself, and I always wished I was more like Amy. I wished I could speak my mind and be bold and upfront and all of those things. And I never was as a teenager. I'm much more now.
You know, when you have a novel where the two main characters are so strong, oftentimes the supporting characters come across as weaker or just cookie cutter, and the supporting characters in your book are not like that at all. I mean, Bronte, Chloe, Amy's mother, Nicole, are all very complicated people. I mean, I think Sanjay could have his own book if you wanted to read about Sanjay, but he's... he's an interesting guy, okay? Chelsea has a question about one of the supporting characters in particular.
Hi, yeah, I wanted to know what exactly Sarah represents, and to follow that, why is it she felt sad for not being invisible?
Oh, shoot, I just missed. Why did Sarah feel bad for not being...
Invisible.
For not being invisible. Wait, what is that from? We're talking about Sarah.
Right. Like, in the part where she says, like, she's in the language class, and she started crying because she realized that she wasn't invisible, and it kind of...
Oh, gosh, yes! I forgot.
You guys are close readers. I love it. I love it.
Oh, that's so sweet of you to point to that. That would have been, you know what's very funny? That's who I was as a teenager myself, who I felt like always, well, not always on the brink of tears, but there was a certain period in my life where I was so shy and self-conscious that I felt like I just didn't want anybody to see me. I would have said I was in 9th or 10th grade, and it would be possible that, and so she has the thing with her mother, and she's suddenly, her mother has died, and so she's suddenly realizing everybody's watching her. And I think if there was any character, if there was any secondary character, it would be her that I connected to for myself, because I also would have been fascinated by someone with a disability who couldn't hide, and who was, so Amy is anything but invisible. Everybody's watching her try to get down the hall and get into and out of class. And I would have watched that person and never had the guts to talk to them. And so I might have actually signed up for that peer mentoring because I wanted to figure out what that was like to be somebody who couldn't hide their problems, that their problems are right out there. And the minute you start going more public with your problems is when you start becoming more self-confident, because you realize everybody shares these. The minute you start talking more about whatever you think is so secretive, you become a bigger, bolder, and better person, I think. And that's hopefully what's happening with Sarah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. That was such a great, I mean, I love that you brought up that that's such a, it's a small moment, but it's a, such a huge Alyssa has a question, another question about your characters.
Do you miss your characters when you finish a novel? Do they stay with you?
Oh, that's a nice question. Actually, here's something very funny where I've gotten a lot of notes from kids or readers who have said, oh, please, I hope you're writing another Amy and Mathew so we know what happens to them. And so I started to think, hey, I'd love to do that. I'd love to find out what happens to them, too. And I started to plot it out. I only spent a day or two doing it. And I thought that I would follow the great example from the master of if I stay and where she went and how they come back and she's it's 4 years later and they're far apart again. And then my editor said, oh, no, I don't think you should do that. You shouldn't write that book because they'll be too old by then. And she's done it so well. That's sort of a classic. And that defies all the don't write a sequel, actually. So I just felt that was very funny for her to say, because here you'd think that they would to revisit these beloved dear characters.
Your editor, too. I mean, because I think that it's the you know, it becomes just like the automatic. Well, of course you're going to write a sequel. Coming from somebody
who's good for her. No, and I would still consider it. So the truth is, I would be interested because, but it was, I think she might have been saying what my idea was. I like the idea that they still have to, they still have to be far apart at the start. That's what I like about where she went. And then they have to find their way back, and they become very different adults. That was so appealing, because that's what happens in life. And these people that re-meet at later on in life have got to re-establish and reconnect and decide who they are as young adults and like that. So I suppose I did. I was very eager to do that. I did miss that. The original question was, do I miss those characters? And the truth is, I really did like these two, and I would love to see what happens with them.
I love the pull quote in the back of the book. I'm going to read it. I've decided that it's possible to love someone for entirely selfless reasons, for all of their flaws and weaknesses, and still not succeed in having them love you back. It's sad, perhaps, but not tragic, unless you dwell forever in the pursuit of their elusive affections. Oh, there's so much wisdom. There's so much wisdom in this book, which leads to a question from Allison.
Hi. I was wondering, like, out of all the great lessons and all these great things in the book, like, what do you most want readers to take away from it?
Oh, that's a great question. I think that what I hope is, I think the original idea, and I'm finishing a book right now that's doing the same thing, is to open people's minds about other kids with disabilities and about, we all see them more now in our schools. When I was a teenager, there wasn't inclusion quite the way there is now, so it was more like kids with Down syndrome and autism and physical disabilities were all somewhere else at a different school. And now they're more out in public. There's also more kids with disabilities. There are 1.2 million teens alone between 12 and 16 with disabilities in America. So that was the original main goal, was that I wanted everybody to read a story about teens with disabilities and see there's far more in common than not, that you share a lot of the same passions and interests, and that we can, if we can figure out how to communicate, especially teens with disability, with communication disabilities. But I also think when I was a teen, I thought the love stories that were the most romantic or meaningful to me were the ones that had this real friendship at the heart of it. And so I kind of wanted to have something about that, about friendship being the real romance, and for people to turn and look at their friends and think about that and consider how emotionally connecting with somebody and somebody that you can really talk to being a romantic interest, being the best romantic interest possible.
Well, you've hinted a little at in what you just said, but we have many fans on Tumblr and Facebook and Twitter want us to get maybe a little bit more. So let's have Kathleen ask what I think is a very important question.
Hi, I wanted to know what you are working on now and if you think you're going to write about more characters with physical and mental disabilities.
Oh, there we go. Great question. I've just finished a book that will hopefully be good enough to come out next fall, and because I just turned it in and we're waiting to hear. I think it's due next fall. Yay! And that has, it's at the center are two teens that are typically developing, and also it's got two narrators and also a narrator with a developmental disability. So she's got Down syndrome or something like Down syndrome. And they're together, and it's surrounding a class about sexuality and relationships for teens with one. Two of them are volunteering in a class on sexuality for teens with disabilities and developmental disabilities, which is very similar to a class that we're running at Whole Children right now. And I want it to be about, again, sort of that divide, about bridging that divide and what we have to learn from each other. And so there's two little relationships, two romances developing at the same time, and hopefully it works. I hope it's great, but that's, we always love it right when you finish it. You think it's so good.
No, not all the time. No, I wish I could say that. No, there's sometimes I'm like,
Oh, it's so clear.
I'm glad you feel that way about this one, at least. Well, our time is up.
Oh,
I told you it would go by quickly. So that's the bad news. The good news is that that Cammie has another book on the way. That's good news. More good news. Ask Authors Anything. We'll be back in the coming months with guests including Co Booth and Lee Bardugo, and who else? You have an idea for somebody you want on the show? Tweet me at Megan McCafferty, or go to my Ask Authors Anything page on Tumblr, or comment on YouTube. There are so many ways to communicate, so many ways. So just tell me who you'd like to see on the show. Or if you live in New Jersey, person, because I will be at the Princeton Children's Book Festival tomorrow, September 20th. Wendy Mass, who was my guest host on my previous episode, will be there with me. We'll be there with alongside 90 other authors and illustrators. It's an awesome day, so if you can be there, it's tomorrow, and then if you're watching this on YouTube, it will already be in the past. But there'll probably be one next year, so whenever you're watching this, just go. It's a great festival. Let's see. Oh, well, until we see each other again then, keep turning the pages or swiping the screens, however, and whatever you read, just keep on reading, because readers like you are why Cammie and I do what we do. Thank you so much for watching. Bye!
Thank you, Megan. Thank you, girls. Those were great questions. This was such a pleasure. So